Penguin Random House Audio presents Vengeance is Mine, a novel by Marie NDiaye, translated from the French by Jordan Stump, read for you by Rebecca Lowman. The man who timidly, almost fearfully, entered her office on January 5th, 2019 was, Met Suzanne realized at once, someone she'd met before, long before, in a place whose memory came back to her with such force and clarity that it felt like a sharp clout to her forehead. Her head snapped back a little, momentarily preventing her from answering the uncomfortable mumble of her visitor's hello. And an awkwardness went on between them, even after Met Suzanne sat down and greeted him warmly, with the cordial, reassuring smile she took care to show everyone who came to see her in her office. Twice, she distractedly rubbed her forehead, thinking she felt a dull ache there, then forgetting all about it. When, that evening, sitting up in her bed, she would again raise a slow, heavy hand toward her brow and then stop herself, since it didn't actually hurt, she would suddenly remember her pain on seeing that man walk into her office, that slight, discreet man, as nondescript in his face as in his figure, which left her very surprised. Why had she felt anguish rather than joy? Why? Convinced that after 32 years she was seeing someone who had enraptured her, did she feel as if her life were in danger? Met Suzanne listened as Gilles Principot went on at length, several times thinking, I know you, and I know your story, mingling her certainty that she'd once been very close to that man with what she knew from the papers of the sorrow that had come to him. Not once in that conversation did he show any sign that he remembered meeting her, that that distant memory had even, perhaps, played some part in his decision to seek her out. Because what high-profile cases did Met Suzanne have to her credit? What, she wondered, could have motivated a well-to-do man, stricken but sane, to choose Met Suzanne for his wife's defense, if not, perhaps, a dim, superstitious allegiance to the luminous moments life had offered him. But Principot said nothing of the reasons, however confused, however foolish, for his choice. He looked at Met Suzanne with a gaze at first evasive and then ever more assured as he answered her questions, and no matter how she tried, Met Suzanne could not, in those eyes fixed on her face, make out any hint of an I know you. She couldn't very well ask him, why did you come to me? I, who am not a lawyer known throughout Bordeaux, particularly given the seriousness of the case. So she let him know that his wife, Marlene Principot, currently in custody, would have to formally accept Met Suzanne as her attorney. Was that what she wanted? Of course it is, he answered, as if it went without saying. And suddenly there was something so brusque and so unlikable in his clenched features that for a moment Met Suzanne doubted she had before her the man she'd never forgotten. Maître Lesser was my wife's lawyer before, but we don't like him, neither one of us, Principot had told her when he came in. So I want a new lawyer, for Marlene's sake. Just as Principot was standing up to leave, she asked if he'd once lived in the Coderon neighborhood. Yes, he said. When I was young, why? He smiled at her then, and his whole face brightened joyously, childishly, now graced with a charm that Met Suzanne noted all the more keenly in that she'd found that same face a minute earlier and to her acute disappointment almost repellent. But what was there to be disappointed about, whether Principot was the one she remembered or had nothing to do with that afternoon? Caught off guard, she answered that as a child she'd known a family in Coderon. She didn't need to hear him exclaim, there are lots of them, to realize the absurdity of her answer. Yes, of course, many people lived in Coderon. Who, to her, was Gilles Principot? How to know? how to trust the thrilling, painful, disturbing intuition that he was once the teenager she'd fallen in love with for all time, long ago, in a Coderon house that she couldn't possibly recognize today. Metsuzanne found herself stumbling over her words. "What was this family's name?" Principo had asked with what seemed eager anticipation, as if already delighting in a connection he would surely find between himself and those people, and even, she thought, as if delighting in the prospect, if necessary, of inventing and substantiating a connection between himself and that family simply to give Metsuzanne the pleasure of something shared, some bond amid everything else.
I don't remember, Metsuzanne mumbled.
In the end, she put on her lawyerly voice again and told him she'd be expecting Madame Principeau's letter appointing her to her defense. She opened the door, stepped aside to let him out. He leaned on the door jamb and in a weak, cavernous voice whispered,
"Only you can save us."
Metsuzanne would later question her memory of that moment, uncertain whether he'd said us or me. He added something banal, something like, "You'll get us out of this nightmare, won't you?" At that, Metsuzanne was more than a little taken aback. Hoping to be rescued from the consequences of some terrible judicial mistake, some outrageous case of mistaken identity, that she would of course understand. But in this case, the nightmare hadn't arisen from some mix-up, some misunderstanding. It was this man's very life, and the acts that were ravaging that life had happened and couldn't be undone, since the dead were not going to extract themselves from his bad dream and be born a second time. So she wondered, did Principo really want to be awakened? Did he really believe that a bright and diaphanous morning would then dawn, and his children would come running to him, unhurt, joyous, and innocent? Exactly what dream was he hoping, by way of Metsuzanne, to be freed from? Freezing rain had put the tram out of service when she went home that night. Had it been only the day before, feeling her shoes slip on the frozen pavement, her first thought would have been for Sharon. "I hope she managed to get to the tram in time," Metsuzanne would have told herself, not liking to see her housekeeper ride off into the cold and the dark on her bicycle. But this night she didn't think of Sharon, absorbed as she was in recalling every detail of Principeau's visit, already feeling anxious when she realized that some of his words hadn't indelibly fixed themselves in her memory. Had he said my wife or my spouse? Had he used her first name, or did Metsuzanne think she remembered it that way because she'd read the name Marlene in the newspaper? Impatient to be back in her apartment so she could write down everything she had left in her head. Who was Gilles Principeau to her? And so, opening the door and finding every light ablaze in the hallway, the dining room, and the kitchen, she was briefly afraid, having forgotten that Sharon might still be there, even with the tram shut down, despite Metsuzanne's many reminders that she was free to go home whenever she thought best, whether the work, of which there was in truth so little, was finished or not. Metsuzanne had always said or suggested to Sharon that she would rather know Sharon was tranquilly looking after her children, helping them with their homework and judiciously thinking of their futures, than find her here at work late in the day. "It makes me uncomfortable," Metsuzanne didn't dare tell her, "that you think it necessary to scour a bathtub I never soak in, to give a weekly washing to windows that are already clean and that I rarely look out of, and to scrub toilets I scrub every day so as to spare you any contact with my private functions." "Yes," Metsuzanne didn't dare tell her. "It makes me very uncomfortable that you take my wish to employ someone to look after my interior so literally, and that in your uprightness and integrity, you somehow manage to spend hours putting the finishing touch on a job that out of modesty and consideration I've already seen to. It makes me uncomfortable, yes, Metsuzan could not tell Sharon. She, who until recently had never felt the need for a housekeeper, who even professed, against that need, an insurmountable prejudice. Sharon, I employ you as an act of militancy, to help you and to further a cause I support, so you don't have to prove to me how scrupulous, honest, and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.